rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, Shaykh.
كيف حالكم؟
الحمد لله، الحمد لله رب العالمين.
ما شاء الله. طيب. We'll start إن شاء الله. Our fiqh class, and we continue discussing different ahkam which is related to yawm al-jumu'ah and salat al-jumu'ah bi-idhni Allah ta'ala. So last week we already discussed some of these hadith, and today inshallah we'll go to the next one. And this hadith that we are going to discuss today is related to at the day of Jum'ah or at Salat al-Jum'ah, the Nafila. As we said before, there is difference between Salat al-Jum'ah and Salat al-Dhuhr. We know that Salat al-Dhuhr has Nafila, which Ratiba, Sunnah, Ratiba. But for Salat al-Jumu'ah, there is no Sunnah Ratiba in general, as it's not concluded in the Sunnah Rawatib, because it's different. It's not the same like Salat al-Dhuhr. But there are some reports and some ahadith, some narrations, which mention doing certain nawafil. Now, let's see what's type of salah or nafila that we can afford before and after salat al-jumu'ah. Brother Abdul Majid, if you just remind the people, brothers in the WhatsApp, because some of them maybe they were confused with different posts about different Zoom meeting. So if you don't mind, just remind them and post the code for our meeting, so maybe they will join. Because even myself, when I start, I was confused between many different Zoom invitation, which is one after the Jazakallah khair. طيب, so let's start with this hadith. عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا صلى أحدكم الجمعة فليصلي بعدها أربعة. Abu Hurairah, radiyallahu anhu, narrated that the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said, whoever prays the Jumu'ah, that means Salatul Jumu'ah, should pray four rak'ah after it. Should pray four rak'ah after it. This report, or this narration, was reported by Al-Imam Muslim. The next one, the next hadith, I just will read the translation. As-Sa'ib ibn Zayd, radiyallahu anhu, said, Anna Muawiyah, radiyallahu anhu, said, if, said to him, whenever you have prayed Jumu'ah, you should not follow it immediately with another prayer unless you have talked or gone out of the masjid, as the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has ordered us to do so, and that we do not follow it, and that we don't follow it with another prayer unless we talk or go out. This is also narrated by or reported by Al-Imam Muslim. Now let's talk about this two hadiths, because both are discussing nafila connected with Yawm al-Jumu'ah. One of them talk about the number, the other one is what? Talk about the way not connected with the salah, I mean between salat al-fariidah and salat al-nafila. Because some people, when they come, after the imam said, As-salamu alaykum, maybe you notice this in some masajid, They stand up and they do the nafila. Anyone who look at them, he think that they added to their salah, or they missed some rak'at. This is what they are doing. And we are going to discuss this in detail, inshallah. Now let's go to the sharh that we are doing, which is the sharh of Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen, rahimahullah ta'ala. He started by, this topic is related to Salatu al Jumu'ah. So, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِذَا صَلَّى أَحَدُكُمُ الْجُمْعَةَ فَلْيُصَلِّ بَعْدَ أَرْبَعَ, if anyone prayed Jum'ah, then he should follow it with أَرْبَعَ رَكَعَات, four rak'ah. What does it mean? Does it mean after we finish the Salah and we mention the name of Allah and we make dua or make dhikr, then we stand up and pray four rak'ah, same like Salatul Dhuhr? No. It's not like this. Because some people, they understand it this way. That even some people, they were confused but because they don't understand this, or they didn't understand this hadith. They thought that the person pray Jum'ah and then he should pray four. So they said, okay, that means we pray Dhuhr also. That's not right. This is why, my dear brothers, it's not just enough for any person just to read the hadith and make a conclusion for himself or his own understanding for this hadith. He should go back to the people of knowledge to understand it. Therefore, let's explain this. So when, after you pray Salatul Jumu'ah in the masjid, and then say salam, and you mention the name of Allah, you say subhanallah, you say adkar, you make dua, wa alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullah. And then you want to make nafila, you pray four according to this hadith. But this four not together. That means you pray two rak'ah and you say salam. And then you pray two rak'ah and then you say salam. So it is four rak'ah but with two salams, two by two, two independent rak'ah, and then you follow it with another two rak'ah with different salam. Now the question, why we didn't do it with one salam? Why we didn't do, you know, these four rak'ah together? Because there are some people, you know, or there's some saying, they follow for the sunnah before Salatul Dhuhr, because there is four rak'ah, as you know, before Salatul Dhuhr. So they do it four all together with one salam. This is one saying of the ulama. We respect this. We understand this. There are some ulama, some scholars, who say that's okay. But if we go to another hadith for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, which was reported by Imam Ahmad and also Abu Dawood and At-Tirmidhi and An-Nasa'i. This hadith, what does it say? It said, Salatul Layli wa Nahar Mathna Mathna. The prayer of day and night, two by two. So now we have two hadith. One said, pray four. The other said, any salah, any nafila, which will be done during the daytime or at night, it should be two by two. This is what they call it, the ulama, al-mutlaq wal-muqayyad. What does it mean, mutlaq and muqayyad? Mutlaq, not restricted. That means general hadith, general instruction giving. Okay, general statement. Okay, this general statement, if there's another statement or another hadith which give restriction, then will we use this restricted hadith to understand this general unrestricted hadith or statement. I hope this is clear. So the Prophet ﷺ said, after Salatul Jum'ah, you do four rak'ah. Great. The other hadith said, if you pray during daytime or at night, then you do it two by two, not together. Therefore, we know in the nafila, always we pray the maximum is two, except as we talked before and discussed, except in the witr, as we explained it at that time. Therefore, we understand from this hadith. that after you pray Salatu al Jumu'ah, we pray two rak'ah and then salam and then two rak'ah. Now look at this. This is saying by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is a statement. This hadith, this instruction from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam come as what? As instructing. Instruction, as saying, as a statement. Why I'm emphasizing this to remind you about this? Because also there is another hadith which talk about the sunnah, but it doesn't talk about it in the matter of statement from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but it talk about it as described by Ibn Umar, by one of the Sahaba who described the action of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we know, as all you know, that the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, either it's come in the form of action, that means he do something, the Sahaba see it, they report it to us, so we say the Prophet do this. This is sunnah. But this is what we call it, sunnatun fi'liya. This is practical sunnah. Other way is sunnatun qawliya. Qawl, saying. So statement or sunnah which comes through what? Through statement that's come from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So now we have two type of sunnah. One by saying and one by action. Which one is more stronger? Now if we have two sunnah, one is by saying and one by action, and there is contradiction between the two, which one should we prefer? We should prefer the statement, the instruction, the saying of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Why? Because this is very clear. This is direct instruction. This is teaching that's come from the mouth of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasallam. But as for the action, it could be understood as sunnah, or it could be understood in other way. If it's a special sunnah, I mean, is it for the Prophet alone? Is it for everyone? Is it, you know, he do it because of a reason? Therefore, if there is two sunnah from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one by action and the other one by saying, and we cannot compromise between them. First of all, we try to make compromise between them. Then we prefer, we take or we follow firstly the sunnah al-qawliyah, which has come in a form of what? In a statement of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why I'm giving this explanation? Because now you will see that we come here with two different sunnah. And I already in the first book I posted the two hadiths. One which about when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that pray four rak'ah after the Jum'ah. And then Ibn Umar, he said what? The hadith which was reported that the Prophet ﷺ, when he finished, when he go home, he prayed two rak'ah at home. And this is why there is two types of sunnah which all talk about the nafila which come after Salat al-Jum'ah. We'll come to this inshallah when we come to the other hadith. طيب. Is this when the Prophet ﷺ said, فَلْيُصَلِّي بَعْدَهَا أَرْبَعًا. Then if you pray Jum'ah, if any of you pray Jum'ah, then let him pray for rak'ah after it. Is it must? Some people, they said this is must. Why? Because this is command. The Prophet ﷺ, فَلْيُصَلِّي. Let him pray. Is it must? We said, no, it is not must. How can we understand? We say this is a command. How can we say it is not must? Because there's other hadith which informed us that the only must salah is al-fariidah, the five obligatory salah. All other nawafil, even the highly recommended nawafil, like sunnat al-fajr, and we cannot say it is must. It is highly recommended. It is confirmed sunnah. The Muslim should keep it or do it. But we cannot say it's obligatory. Because when we say obligatory, that means the one who doesn't do it, he is committing sin. But it is nafilah. So be careful about this. So al-amru laysa lil-wujub. Al-amr laysa lil-wujub. That means this command is not to make it must, but lil-istihbab, to recommend it. Na'am. The other hadith that I mentioned, it is the hadith of Abdullah ibn Umar radiyallahu anhum. May Allah be pleased with him and his father. He said, now he's describing, he didn't, you know, reported to us a statement of the Prophet ﷺ. He said, أَنَّ النَّبِيَّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ كَانَ يُصَلِّي رَكْعَتَيْنِ بَعْدَ الْجُمُعَةِ فِي بَيْتِهِ. He said, the Prophet صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ, he used to pray two rak'ah after Jum'ah in his house. In his house. And this hadith, by the way, was reported by whom? By Al-Imam Al-Bukhari in the book of Jum'ah, and also by Al-Imam Muslim. So it is muttafaqun alayh. It is hadith which was reported by Al-Imam Al-Bukhari and Al-Imam Muslim, which was Abdullah ibn Umar is telling us about the action, what did Prophet ﷺ do when he go to his house after he pray Jum'ah, he do two rak'ah there. Now let's come to discuss this. Should we pray four or should we pray two? The Prophet ﷺ say pray four. And the action that he did is that he prayed two at his home. So the ulama, they have been, you know, discussing this, you know, and they try to make compromise between these two hadiths. Right. So some of them, they said, it is better to pray four rak'ah after the Jum'ah in the masjid, and then when you go home, you pray two rak'ah. In this way, that you follow the statement, sunnah, and also you follow the sunnah or the practical sunnah. Others, they said, this depends, because Ibn Umar said when he go home, he pray two. Therefore, if you, after you finish the Jum'ah, if you want to do the nafilah which come after the Jum'ah at the masjid, then you pray what? You pray four in the masjid. Because the Prophet ﷺ said, let him pray. That means after you finish, you right away, you pray that this four rak'ah. Two and two. And if you want to pray at home, he left after Salatu al Jumu'ah, he didn't pray nafilah, then you do it two rak'ah at home. So both are correct. This is what some ulama said. Others, they said, we should, as I mentioned at the beginning in my introduction, we should follow the statement. Because the statement is more stronger, and always we prefer it or make it first than the action. And this is what was the choice of our Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen, that we are studying his book and explaining this. He said, إِذَا تَعَارَضَتِ السُنَّةُ الْقَوْلِيَّةِ وَالسُنَّةُ الْفَعْلِيَّةِ قُدِّمَتِ الْقَوْلِيَّةِ. He said, if there is a contradiction between the sunnah, which is a statement by the Prophet, and sunnah, which is action done by the Prophet, there is a contradiction between these two sunnah, then we follow the statement. This is the statement. So, if we do this, that means we will pray this four rak'ah, and this is the preferred. And as we said, to get out of this confusing problem, or in a discussion, then it's better, you know, to do both. Pray to, for rak'at at the masjid before you leave to your home. And when you arrive your home, you pray to rak'at. And then, mashallah, you follow both sunnah. طيب, now the question is there nafila before Salatul Jum'ah? Yeah, this is very important to understand, because some people, they confuse between the Jum'ah and Dhuhr. So when they come to the masjid, Yawm al-Jum'ah, what they do? They do for rak'at. They think it is this Salatul Jum'ah at the time of Salatul Dhuhr. Therefore, I will do four rak'ah as I do in every day. We say this is wrong because Jum'ah is not Dhuhr. Friday is not like a noon prayer. So is there specific nafila before Salatul Jum'ah? There is none. Okay. What should one do? Now let's look what the Sahaba they did. And there's also hadith telling what we do. So before Salatul Jum'ah, if you arrive to the masjid, Yawm al-Jum'ah, early, first of all, for sure, you will do two rak'ah, tahiyyat al-masjid. And then you try to pray as much as you can. That means, as we said, you pray two by two by two. How many? You may pray 20 if you came early. You may pray more or less. Or maybe, in every two rak'ah, you recite and stand longer. So this depends on you. It's up to you. There is no specific number of rak'ahs before Jum'ah. But be careful. When it's come before noon, that's mean 10 minutes, 12 minutes before noon, before the adhan, then you should stop. Why? Because this is the time which is prohibited to offer any sunnah or any nafilah. And this, in every day, either Jum'ah or other day, except for a person who arrived at that time. A person who arrived at the masjid, even it was prohibited time, then he, before he sat, he should pray, or he is recommended for him to pray the two sunnah, which is tahiyyat al-masjid. Otherwise, if you are in the masjid, then you should not stand up and pray at this time. Now, there are others saying, if you have been come early and you continue pray, even this time, start, and you are in your prayer, there is no problem. Because this was mentioned in some narrations that the Sahaba, the companion of the Prophet ﷺ, they used to continue pray when they come to Jum'ah till the Imam come, which means maybe it's included before this time. But anyway, but the mistake that some people do, what they do, they come, they pray two, four rak'ah, and then they sit. Just because the Imam come 10 minutes before, they stand up and they want to pray. And they said, this is the sunnah of Sahaba. They do this. We said, this is wrong. And you should not do it. And if we see somebody, we should advise him. Why? Because you initiate nafila at the time which is prohibited to pray nafila at that time. Now, because it was, as we mentioned, the Sahaba, they come, and pray as many as they can in this day. Now, the next hadith, which was narrated by As-Sa'ib ibn Yazid, who said, the Mu'awiyah رضي الله عنه, said that if you pray Jum'ah, don't connect another salah with it. That means don't, after the Imam say, As-Salaamu Alaykum wa Rahmatullah, As-Salaamu Alaykum wa Rahmatullah, you say, As-Salaamu Alaykum wa Rahmatullah, As-Salaamu Alaykum wa Rahmatullah, and then you stand up right away and start another pray nafila. This, it's like connection. You just break it with salam. So the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, don't connect another salah till you talk, speak, or you leave the masjid, get out. Some ulama, they said, or at least you moved from the place where you prayed the Jum'ah. You are in this line, you pray, you say salam, at least move from this place, one step forward, one step back, right or left. The important thing that don't continue praying in the same place. Or speak. Now, what type of speak is this? There's a difference between ulama also. They said, some of them, that it should not be of the speak that is allowed in the salah. That's mean like remembering Allah, saying subhanallah, saying adhkar, because this is allowed in the salah. What was mentioned here, that you speak a talk of this life, worldly matter, which if somebody see you or hear you, he knows, he realizes that you are not in Salah, that you get out of the Salah. Therefore, then you can pray these two nafila. So this is the hadith here, which is mentioned. So here we have three things. Exit the masjid, because he said move till he get out. This is one. Or move from one place to other. Or talk. Then you can pray this nafila. Pray this nafila. Therefore, the ulama said, it is sunnah that al-faslu bayn al-fard wa sunnatihi bikalam. It is sunnah. It is recommended that always we make, you know, break between the fariza and the sunnah. That means not only on Friday. Let's say that you pray Salat al-Dhuhr and you say Salam. Don't stand upright away and pray. You should make break between the fariza that you finish and the sunnah that will come after it. Either by speaking, talk, or by moving from your place, or maybe you get out, exit the masjid, and you pray at your home. But sometimes, as you know, for example, we are in Haram, and the Haram is, especially in Ramadan, you know, when you say As-Salam, and there is no way to go. You cannot move even from your place, because you will not find other place. Is it okay to pray? Yes. But maybe say salam to the person beside you, talk to somebody, or maybe make adhkar, or stay a little while, and then you stand up and you pray, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is very merciful. Now, which is better, to pray the sunnah at home or at the masjid? For sure, at home is better, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Afdal salat al-mar'i fi bayti illa al-maktuba." That's mean the best and the more rewarded salah, which is mean the nafila, is when you do it at home, except what? Except salat al-fariza, except the obligatory salah. And it was the way the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam always, he do all the nawafil, all the sunnah rawatib, always he do it at home and never did it in the masjid. So he do it at home when he hear the adhan, he make the sunnah at home, and then he go out to lead the people in the salah. After he finish his salah, he go home and he do the nafila that which come after the fariza. Okay, no, let's go to the next hadith. This hadith, which was reported by Abu Hurairah, also narrated Abu Hurairah, radiyallahu anhu, who said, whoever perform ghusl, and you know ghusl, this is spiritual bathing, that you take it, I mean, this bath with the intention of pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ghusl. Then comes to the Jum'ah. And we know that the ghusl is of two types. Ghuslun wajib wa ghuslun mustahab. Recommended ghusl and obligatory ghusl. We know the obligatory ghusl is what? As a result of what? Of janaba. Or for the ladies after they finish their menstruations. Or after, you know, the stopping of the bleeding after childbirth. This ghusl called ghusl wajib. That means it's must. Should be done because the person is in a state of janaba or major impurity. But there's other aghsal, other different ghusl, which is recommended and it's not must. Like for Jum'ah, Friday, is the sound view that it is not must, but it is highly recommended ghusl. Also for Salat al-Eid, when you go to, or when you want to perform istard ihram, all these are mustahab. He said, whoever perform ghusl, that's mean in Friday, then comes to the Jum'ah prayer, and prays as many raka'ah as much. Be careful about this point here. He came to the Jum'ah, that means he came to the masjid. And prays as many rak'ah, as much as Allah has written for him, and then he remains silent and listen until the imam finish his khutbah. So we learn that the person, when he go to the Jum'ah, what he should do, according to this hadith, expected to do, pray as much as he can. This is what we said, that there is no specific limited nafila before Salatul Jumu'ah. But you stand in prayer, pray two rak'ah after two rak'ah after two rak'ah, till the imam come. Or you may hold before, as we said, 10 minutes before the noon time. Until the imam finish his khutbah, and then prays with him, that's been pray with the imam, Salatul Jumu'ah, his sins between this present Friday and the next one would be forgiven, and even the sins of 3 days more. This is a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Blessing from Allah azza wa jalla. If the person prays Jumu'ah, according to this hadith, he came early, he prayed as much as he can, then he waited and listened to the imam, and then prayed the Jum'ah with the imam, Allah Azza wa Jal, out of his mercy, will forgive him all his sins. The sins of this week and 3 more days. That's been 10 days. But always, my dear brothers and sisters, remember that whatever hadith which talk about, you know, these ibadat or nawafil that erase the sins, like between from Friday to Friday, it will forgive all sin between them. From Ramadan to Ramadan, all sins will be forgiven by the will of Allah Azza wa Jal. See? This relates to minor sin. Minor sins, not the major sin. As the ulama said, the major sin required repentance. The major sins required repentance. That means the person should repent to Allah Azza wa Jal, and there is certain condition for repentance. Inshallah, we'll talk about it maybe sometime. طيب. نعم. The next hadith, which was narrated also by Abu Hurairah رضي الله عنه, he said, the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم mentioned the virtues of Friday, and he said, on Friday there is an hour. That means there is time. When we said hour, does it mean, you know, hour, this is 60 minutes. That means there is time in which no Muslim who matches this hour, that means at that specific time, praying, this is one, and asking Allah for something, except that Allah will grant him whatever he asked for. Whatever he asked for, is it open? No limit. Now for sure there is a limit. What type of limit? That means this dua should be for goodness, not to curse people, okay, especially Muslim, or okay, not to talk or say something bad about your relatives, or asking something which is forbidden. That means you ask something which is lawful. Which is lawful. Then Allah will grant it to you by the will of Allah Azza wa Jal. But this time is very short, because there's other hadith that you know, the Prophet ﷺ, he mentioned with his hand, you know, a sign that to show that it is very little time. And ulama have many different saying about this hour or this part of time. First of all, when and how long. But the most sound view limited this time between two times. The time when the Imam come to give the khutbah till the end of the salah, because there is some narrations about this. The other time is the last hour of the day of Friday, that means after Asr and before Maghrib. These are the most famous time that was some of the ulama mentioned regarding this. Now let's see what our Shaykh explained about this, because we need to understand this and then, you know, clearly. First of all, he said, يُوَافِقُهَا, that means anybody who do this dua at that time. So what should you ask? First of all, we should ask the blessing of Allah of the hereafter to save us from the hell and to grant us Jannah. This is the most important thing. Whoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala moved him away from the hell, the fire, that he is real successor. This is what Allah Azza wa Jal said. وَمَنْ زُحْزِحَ عَنِ النَّارِ وَدْخِلَ الْجَنَّةِ فَقَدْ فَازْ. The one who was removed away from the fire and he was allowed to enter paradise, this is the real successor. So this is, but you can ask whatever thing except something which is forbidden, as you said. Now, the Prophet ﷺ while he is praying, so this is a condition here. Does this mean this salah, that's while he is standing in prayer, or in the general meaning of praying? What does it mean, the general meaning? Because the word qa'im, that means he's standing, or he's doing this. Now, this qa'im, it's mean doing this thing. So the person who come, for example, he came early, he prayed the Asr. And after Asr, there is no nafila. There is no nafila. So how come we said after Asr, this is the time to make dua, will be accepted in Jum'ah, and we know there is no nafila after Salatul Asr. Why they said this? They said because when you pray Asr and you stay at your place waiting for Salat al-Maghrib, then you are waiting for the Salah, then you could be considered as you are in Salah. So not real sense of standing in prayer, but you are in the position that you are in, you know, you are doing or waiting for the Salah. So the ulama say this. It's interesting that the ulama, as Al-Hafiz ibn Hajar, rahimahullah, said, they have more than 40 saying about the time of this hour. The question is, why it is hidden? Subhanallah, this is the wisdom of Allah Azza wa Jal. Like the hidden of Laylatul Qadr. No, we know that about the verses of Laylatul Qadr. And Allah Azza wa Jal told us, as the Prophet ﷺ explained to us, that it will be in the last 10 nights of Ramadan. What night? We don't know. But what the purpose? The purpose is that to spend as much as we can of our time to get closer to our Lord, Creator, by praying, by doing good deeds. And this, in fact, will be in our scale. So this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not mention or explain or identify this exact time. So the Muslim on Friday, he will be alert to try to get benefit of every minute to make dua. So he will make dua that minute. So therefore, as we mentioned, there are two times, and I will finish with this inshallah. As we said, the first one is when the Imam come. So the Imam come to the masjid. He said, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Greeting the Musallin. Then the Muaddin will come, start, and making Adhan. We know that after the Adhan, we are what? It is recommended that after the Adhan, you should repeat up with the Muaddin. And then after the Adhan, you say the Salah in the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And then you make dua. So this is the right time to make this dua, according to this. Because dua after adhan is accepted. And dua at this time also could be, come at the time which is accepted, according to this hadith. Is there other time? Yes. Till the imam finish the salah, not only the khutbah. So if the imam, pause between the two khutbah, you can make dua. But don't make dua while the imam is giving the khutbah, delivering the khutbah. We've mentioned this before, that we should listen to the imam. Okay. Aqamat al-salah. In your sujood, when you are prostrate in the salah, also you can make the dua. Before you say salam, Salatu al Jumu'ah, also you can make dua. All this is great time that could be blessed time that Allah Azza wa Jalla will accept your prayer. Till the finish of the salah. The other time, as we said, which come at the end of the day, and this is what some ulama said. Our Shaykh said, it could be, this time of the salah is more sound because this is the time all people are praying, people and a prayer, okay? And many people, the Muslim, are praying. So this is a good time that may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, beside, before they pray, they listen to the khutbah, their heart may be attached, to the blessing of Allah Azza wa Jal. Therefore, this is what was recommended. But we should, as we said, we should make dua, at all time. Now, after Salat al-Asr, as we said, it is not time for the Salah. So how can we come and said while he's praying? As we mentioned, this could be understood in that he is waiting for the prayer. So I will stop here, inshallah, and then I will listen and take your questions. So brothers and sisters, if you have questions, you can ask. For those brothers and sisters who are follow us on the Facebook, you can write your question on the in the comment area. And we'll come, inshallah, we'll reply to it. Jazakumullah khair. Fadal,
mashallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, Shaykh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
I have a question, Shaykh, regarding the ladies who are praying the dhuhr at home.
Naam.
Do they have to wait until the imam has finished the salah, or they can pray the
dhuhr
according to the
dhuhr? No, when the time of dhuhr as usual start on Friday, so because she is not praying Jum'ah, so when the adhan of the dhuhr, which is the time of the dhuhr, start of the time of the salah, then she can do her nafila and then she can pray the dhuhr. She doesn't need to wait till the imam the masjid finish, because there's no connection here. Unless they know that she went, some ladies, they would like to watch the haram, listen to the khutbah, or maybe listen to the imam, they hear the khutbah, but there's no connection. If she want after the adhan, pronounced and declare, then she can do her nafil and then pray the dhuhr. Naam. Yes. Wa iyyakum. Naam. Any questions? Okay, if anybody want to ask by writing, maybe some people, they don't want to speak, they want to ask by writing, no problem, they can write. The question. Bye. Nah. Okay, so if there's no question, inshallah, we'll conclude our class. And still, you have a chance. Whenever any question comes to your mind, just post it in the group or in the comments of the Facebook. And we'll see you, inshallah, next week at 7. 15. جزاكم الله خير بارك الله فيكم والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته. جزاكم الله خير.